Good morning. We welcome you here to Liberty Baptist Church this brand new year of 2019. There's some of you that didn't think that you would make it that far, but you did. So congratulations. And if you're visiting with us today for the first time, we'd love for you to fill out a visitor's card. It's in a pocket near you there in the chairs, and we'd love for you to fill that out. Well, we have a lot going on, so I'm going to jump into our announcements here. We had 127 in Sunday school, and we started today counting contacts. We had 58. So we probably had more than that, but maybe they weren't counted or reported. So we're going to look forward to seeing that number go up. In this busy week that we've got, we have Deacons Meeting and Baptist Women's Meeting tomorrow night. Tuesday, we have our tag luncheon at 12. The Morgan County Historical Society is going to be sharing information about the Gobi community. And we've had a lot of people sick or doctor's appointments or they forget. But we would like to have a good group here, more than 10 or 15 for this presentation on Tuesday. So maybe you've never come before and, you know, you're retired, just never have made that a part of your schedule to come Tuesday at noon. But it's a great time. We meet in the fellowship hall downstairs in the activity center, and we would love to see you there. And if you can bring a dish, we would love for you to do that too. On Wednesday, we have business meeting and the youth council's meeting at 8 o'clock over at the activity center. And then this Friday night is going to be Liberty Night at Wartburg High School. Now, we got 6 p.m., but the girls' game starts at 6:30 and the boys' game at 8. But where we usually have our cheering section is if you go in the gym from the foyer, it's all the way on the left side. So we hope that you will be able to be there Friday night to cheer our local high school on. Vision Committee is meeting the following Monday night. And then we've got several events that are coming up. Baptist Men's Day is going to be January 20th. So we're looking forward to sharing with that. And we've got three men that are going to give their testimony, and that we're excited about that. And then on the 24th, there's going to be an NAAA celebration dinner. And we're going to be celebrating the fact that NAAA has been at our church for 2 years. It's going to be the 7-year, is that right? 7-year anniversary of Ronnie being drug-free. And Jerry, 2 years. So that is really, really exciting. And so we have a sign-up sheet back there, and you've got three options, okay? You can sign up to donate food and just get it here. You don't have to come. You can go and not bring food. That's option number two. Or you can go and bring food, okay? It's going to be in upstairs Fellowship Hall at the Activity Center. So looking forward to that. All right, Miss Valerie has an announcement to make about small groups.
I promise I won't be, but just a second. But I want to thank y'all for your patience. It's been the devil's been after me about this. The sickness, just it's been slow getting this launched, and I apologize that it's taken so long, but we are finally starting to see some progress and got lots of things planned. The first one launches. There's one of these on the window out there, and I'll post some more as well. But this is the five love languages, and some of you are probably already familiar with that book, the Gary Chapman book. And Miss Stacy Young, let me get your Mosier. No. Warner. I had it on here, but I couldn't remember. Is going to lead that group, and it's going to start January 20th. And we are looking at a Sunday evening, and we've got a sign-up sheet out there. We've got, obviously we want your name and your phone number, and then you can choose. We're not sure which time slot's going to be most effective for people. We found that we do D groups like at 4 o'clock in the afternoon before church, and that works great. So that's an option. The other option would be at 6 o'clock, which is when church starts. But you can come to the study group instead of coming in to regular church for these 8 to 9 weeks is what we expect it to take. Right now, we don't know whether this is going to be all women, all men, or co-ed. We can go either way on this. So if you're interested, just sign up. Just sign up and let us know you're interested, and then we'll figure out how we'll communicate with you, and we'll figure out how we're going to do it. But please think about it. Please pray about it. This will be out here for this week and at least through next week. But we do want a good little group. I think it's the 5 love languages is a great book. It's not hard. It's not going to stress you out. You're just going to learn what you need to know that what is the words of affirmation is mine. I want somebody bragging on me. And then my second one would be quality time. I don't care anything about receiving gifts. I don't care anything about acts of service. But if you want to make me happy, you tell me you appreciate me. And then you're going to spend quality time with me. And that's what you learn, is that kind of thing, is what is it makes you happy. And that way your spouse or your significant other can be doing that. And you can be doing it for them too. If you don't know that, you know, if you've got a husband who really needs words of affirmation, but he doesn't tell you that, how are you going to know it? So it's a great study, and it's not hard. So be thinking about it, and like I said, Miss Stacy's going to lead us on it, and we're real excited about that. So if you have any questions, holler at either one of us, but there's a sign up sheet.
All right, thank you, Valerie. And also, if you've not signed up for the men's night out over at Second Baptist Clinton, there is a sign up sheet back there. The first set of tickets have already been ordered, but it's still not too late. But you may not be a part of the dinner, I think. So you can still go. You just have to take your own sandwich, I guess. But anyway, several people have already signed up for that. Also, today we started the contact emphasis, and our Sunday school director, Zanny Knox, wants to share more about that.
Well, good morning. As we've been looking at doing more outreach and just contacting folks who we maybe haven't seen in a while or maybe not even gotten to meet yet, our family, our friends, our neighbors, you've read some about that. You've heard from Pastor Paul on that, and it's really exciting. So we know we've gotten, 58 contacts this week, and that is outside of church hours. So that's part of our daily lives. And so we want to look at it a little more. How could we go about doing that? Well, it's really not very complicated. You could see we could write cards, which a lot of folks are already doing, so it's really nothing new. We can make phone calls, say hello to a neighbor as we're passing by, knock on the door, just say hi. Social media is always out there. A lot of great opportunities, and that's just to name a few, okay? The real question, I think, though, is why do we do that? And it comes back down to the Great Commission. And in Matthew 28, Jesus said, "All authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age." So that's the why. We're going to make disciples, to put it simply. And at the core of that, hand in hand with that, is the greatest commandment, which is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, as Jesus says in Matthew 22, with all your soul, with all your mind. And the second is like it. He says, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself." And an expression of that love is to reach out and say, "Hey, come join us. Come fellowship with us. Come learn about God. Hey, most importantly, let me introduce you to somebody. Let me introduce you to Jesus Christ, who changed my life, who gave me hope." So as we reach out to folks. You're going to see in Sunday school classes just a visual reminder. We've got these in each of our Sunday school classrooms. Please remember to reach out to folks and contact them and share the love of Jesus with them. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Zandy. As we go to the Lord in prayer, beginning our worship service this morning, I would remind you to continue to pray for Ray Tilson, who is at the Oak Ridge Hospital. Also, I would ask that you would continue to pray for my father, who as of tomorrow will be transitioning to long-term care in the facility that he's in now, and just praying that he'll continue to be content in being there. And I know that many of you have concerns and you have silent requests in your hearts, and we're going to take all that now to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we begin this worship service today, this first worship service of the year 2019, Heavenly Father, help us that we could dedicate ourselves, that this year we would glorify your name through our lives. Help us through the struggles and the challenges that we face. And help us, Heavenly Father, to know your will and to carry it out in our lives. We ask that you would be with Ray and Jeanette, and Lord, we pray your healing hand, Lord, could touch him in a miraculous way, that he could turn a corner that would indicate just true progress in his condition. We pray, Heavenly Father, for all the concerns that are on our hearts, knowing, Heavenly Father, that you are the answer to every question that we have in life, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning and welcome to you to Liberty Baptist Church. Let's start off the first church service of the new year by singing hymn number 132. Let's stand as we sing Hosanna, Praise is Rising. Number 518, My Life is in You, Lord.
this is my Father's world. Near you this morning. That you join us as we sing the last verse of 46, This Is My Father's World.
This is my
can sing our offertory hymn. Our choir can go down and join our congregation as we get ready to sing hymn number 101. Excuse me, 101, How Deep the Father's Love for Us. How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure.
Thank you for another day in your house here today. We thank you for all your blessings on us. Lord, blessed with our country and our church. Lord, bless these tithes and offerings. Bless Pastor Paul as he leads our service today. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, I pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, Joellen. I invite you to turn in your copy of God's Word to the book of Proverbs. We're going to be looking at Proverbs chapter 3. We're going to be looking at verses 5, 6, and 7. If you've been in church very long, these are very familiar verses. And as we start off this brand new year, I hope that these words from God's Holy Scripture can be of inspiration to each of us as we seek to live our lives for Him in this year of 2019. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Do not be wise in your own eyes. Fear the Lord and depart from evil. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, help us to understand how to apply these principles to our lives on a daily basis, because, Lord, we need your help, we need your strength, we need your wisdom, and it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Whenever a new year starts, people think about the great potential of that year and of wanting, if you're a Christian, to serve the Lord. And so I found this prayer for the new year. Dear Lord, so far this year, I've done well. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. I haven't been greedy, grumpy, nasty, selfish, or overindulgent. I'm very thankful for that, but in a few minutes, Lord, I'm going to get out of bed. And from then on, I'm probably going to need a lot of help. Amen. Well, maybe you've already felt that way. I've had several people tell me, I hope 2019 is better than 2018. And we hope that each year. But we also know that each year will have not only the blessings, but also challenges. And how are we going to trust the Lord in the midst of those challenges? Are we going to acknowledge His ways? The first point I want to talk about is to trust the Lord with all your heart. We know that we need to live our lives in such a way that we rely upon, that we trust, that we believe in God. with all of our hearts. And yet, how many times are we half-hearted about our faith and our relationship with the Lord? The Lord tells us, hey, you need to do this, or you need to change that, and we do not obey Him. We do not trust Him. We question what He is saying to us. How many times do we lean on our own understanding rather than leaning on the Lord, His wisdom, His direction, His perfect will for our lives? How many times do we go through our lives and we have our habits and our routines and this is the way we make decisions, but we don't acknowledge Him in all of our ways? And we don't even let Him direct our paths, the way we walk. So I want to talk about how we can trust the Lord the way we ought to. And I have here three suggestions on the ways that God helps us to know what is right to do for our lives. The first one is by conscience. And I have some scriptures to go along with each of these points to help us to understand how it is that we can trust the Lord, how it is that we can know God's will for our lives. And we're told in John chapter 8, verse 9, then those who heard it, being convicted by their conscience, went out one by one, beginning with the eldest even to the last, and Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. This particular episode is a time in which a woman was caught in adultery, and this was a trap set up not only for that woman but also for Jesus to see how He would handle this very difficult circumstance. And we know that He leaned down and He wrote in the sand, and I'd love to know what He was writing there in the dirt. Maybe He was going, hey, Hezekiah, I know what you were doing last night. Or maybe, Elijah, I know what's in your heart. We don't know exactly what He was writing. But whatever He was writing, it was convicting their hearts. Even these people who were bent on evil, these people who were trying to set up a trap for the Son of God, these people who were seeking to do harm, even they, in that circumstance, their conscience spoke to them. They were convicted. Now, my friends, we need to realize that God has given us an internal moral compass, and that the fall of mankind and our own sin distorts it. And I tell you, you know, I hope, as a Christian, that when you look at the society and the culture that we're in, the moral compass of this society is all messed up. It's just like the needle, just spinning, spinning, spinning. And what happens is, when we go through a difficult situation and we let hatred or unforgiveness or hurt, we let that control us, or we hold grudges, or we don't live the Christian life the way we ought to, what happens is we dull our conscience. And people can get to the point where they don't know what's up or down, they don't know what's good or bad, they just know what feels good. And you know what? What feels good most of the time is really not good for you, is it? I mean, it's not. And we are so susceptible to any distraction that is around us. I'm amazed at how, you know, Joellen can make this great dinner and we're sitting there after supper and we're watching TV and the Pizza Hut commercial comes on and I'm like, man, I could eat a fourth of that. My mind's telling me that. My stomach's saying, you better not. You better not. And it goes on and on and on like that, where we become totally misdirected in how we live. But God gives us our conscience if we'll but listen to it. He also gives us His holy word. In the book of Hebrews, that very difficult book to read and understand, but it's worthy of reading, because of its depth. For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to division of soul and spirit and of joint and marrow, and is the discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. So God's word is living. That's why you need to have a Bible reading program. I've got one that I've published out there that I developed that's out there on the desk there in the foyer. But you need to be reading God's word in a systematic way every single year. It doesn't matter if you read the whole Bible, but you need to be sure that you're dipping into all the major parts of the Bible. It is living in the sense that if you keep reading it and reading and reading, absorbing it, understanding it, what happens is you'll go along and you'll say, you know, I've read this passage 10 times, 20 times, 30 times. I might be able to say 35 times. But wow, God revealed something to me about what it was saying, or it applied to my life today. That's why it's a living document. It's the living word. Because as you continue to grow and change, go through different life circumstances, God's word can speak to you in a powerful way. Sharper than a two-edged sword, it pierces even the division of soul and spirit. You can't do that with a physical instrument, okay? You can't do that with a laser. Only God's word can do that. And it discerns the thoughts and intents of the heart. And see, that's where the Bible gets real honest with us, doesn't it? We smile, good to see you, maybe. And God knows our true intentions. We can come to church, put on a suit, tie, do all these things, but God knows what's really in our hearts. And He's trying to reveal to us what our hearts are so that we can be honest with ourselves. That's where it's got to start. And then maybe we can be transparent and real with other people. By our conscience, God reveals His will by God's word, but also through others. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1. Brethren, if a man is overtaken, or a woman, is overtaken in any trespass, you who are spiritual, restore such a one in a spirit of gentleness, considering yourself, lest you also be tempted. Okay, what is that saying? When you see someone careening over the edge of the cliff, you don't sit back and say, this is a disaster, this is a disaster, this is a disaster. You seek in a loving, caring, gentle way to say, don't do that. Okay? Be careful. And why is it that we must do that in a spirit of gentleness? Consider yourself, lest you also be tempted. I'm telling you this because I love you. Rather than, you know, if you do that, you're going to be in another mess, just like all the other ones I warned you about, and you didn't listen. Our Christianity could use a lot more gentleness. You know it? It's kind of like the salt and the pepper that you put on. You shouldn't use a lot of salt, but I use pepper, but it's the seasoning. I like to be able to taste my food. That's why I like Mexican. I want it hot, but I don't want it so hot that all I'm thinking about is where is the nearest water hydrant, which I've had that happen before. I should have known I shouldn't have picked up that hot sauce when it had a legal disclaimer on it. Seriously, I did that one time. I thought, hey, I can handle this. Use of this product can cause injury or death. And for a while, I wasn't sure which one was going to happen to me. I mean, it was really, really bad. I take those very seriously. We all at times will need someone to gently help us. All of us. Me too. All of us. And we need to be sure that we are doing that. God has a will for our lives. He has a way for our lives. And so we have to trust Him. We have to lean on Him. We have to acknowledge Him and know that if we'll do that, He will direct us on the path that He has for us. I was reading about one of the editors of our Daily Bread. That's a neat little devotional that's out there that if you need something that is real short because of the hurried life that you're living, or you don't like to read and so you want something short, whatever reason, they're all good. But he tells a story about early on in his career that this job that he had was slowly turning into a ministry, and he loved his job and he loved what he was doing, and God was blessing what he was doing, and he just got great joy and fulfillment out of this job. Well, then someone found out about what he was doing and they offered him another job that paid even more money, a lot more money. And so he was kind of mulling this over and, what should I do? I wasn't really looking for a job. Our family could use this extra money. I haven't heard anyone say, I don't need any more money, we could use that more money to help our family. So he thought, I'm going to call Dad, see what Dad says. So he explains everything to his dad. His dad at this time was in his 70s. His mind was slowed down a little bit by some of the strokes that he had had and the strain of the years, but his answer was crisp and clear. This is what he said. Don't even think about the money. What would you do? And he was like, wow, the money is the only reason for changing this job. Thanks, Dad. And he stayed where he was. Now the world would say, are you crazy turning down more money? But God blessed this editor as he stayed where he was and his work blossomed. So we have to trust in the Lord's way. Now I added verse 7 in our reading today because a lot of times we read verses 5 and 6 and that's fine, but then verse 7 is a very important addition, I think, if we're going to have the total picture of how we ought to live and how we ought to respond to what God is telling us. Because it says, do not be wise in your own eyes, fear the Lord, and depart from evil. So what does it mean to fear the Lord? What does it mean to depart from evil? Now, we live in a modern age where even liberal theologians will tell us, fearing God, that's very archaic. It's kind of like how on The Wizard of Oz, they kind of feared the wizard until they saw who he really was. Well, you know what? God is not an angry man hiding behind a curtain, okay? He is the creator of the universe who loves every single one of us and sent his son to die for us on the cross of Calvary. And this heavenly Father loves us and he wants what's best for us. He wants our happiness. And we need to fear him because he made everything. We ought to be able to look around and see the intricacy of the human body and the vastness of space, the beauty of nature, and we ought to say, man, only God could do that. That's right, amen? Only God could do that. That's no accident. That's no process of evolution. But if we're going to fear God, sooner or later it has to impact our behavior, okay? It has to impact our behavior. The Apostle Paul talks about this. It's almost as if the book of Galatians is a commentary on Proverbs chapter 3. Because as I was studying for this sermon, it seemed like that the New Testament explanation of these verses were found in Galatians. Galatians chapter 5, starting in verse 16, he talks about walking in the Spirit. And we already saw that idea of walk in Proverbs. Paul says, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. And we think of the lust of the flesh as just sexual lust or greed or something, but the fact is that when we are searching for something other than God and trying to get those earthly needs fulfilled, we're lusting after it. Okay? Verse 17, for the flesh lusts against the spirit. See, you notice the word lust there is different. For the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh, and these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. The power of sin. Then you kind of go back to Romans chapter 7 and see an explication of that. Okay. Now there's a conditional statement then made in verse 18. But if, I mean, he could have just said but, or he could have said if. He says, but if, to be sure that you see the disjunction there. But if you are led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. Because we know that checking boxes off and say, oh yeah, I did that, and that. I'm finished, I'm done, I'm perfect. That doesn't work. Now the works, because that is a work of the flesh. Now the works of the flesh are evident. Say obvious. Which are adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lewdness, idolatry, sorcery, hatred, contentions, jealousies, outburst of wrath, selfish ambitions, dissensions, heresies, envy, murder, drunkenness, revelries, and the catch-all phrase that a lot of people don't like, that phrase, and the like. And everything else, in other words, that'd be a better way to try it. And everything else that you know through your conscience that we talked about in point one is wrong, okay? People say, oh, well, you know, that's a pretty complete list. But in case you go, wow, I haven't done any of those things, which, you know, you'd be a liar if you say I hadn't done those things. Well, how about in the like? How about in the rest of it? Okay? You can't say you fear God and do these things, friends. Okay? And you certainly can't justify them. So, it says, envy, murders, drunkenness, revelries, and the like, of which I tell you beforehand, just as I also told you in time past, that those who practice such things, doesn't say those who commit such things, okay? Those who practice such things. In other words, what do you do when you practice something? Hopefully you're getting better. Keep doing that and 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 keep doing that. And then you keep doing that, okay? And practice such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. Why? It isn't that you get saved and then get lost, as you weren't ever saved to begin with. If you're in the world and you become saved by word only, by label only, and then you just like, you know, the only difference is I go to church, but I keep doing all these things, you're not saved, you're lost. I don't care if you've been baptized 5 times, 25 times, you are lost, lost, bound for hell, friends. Because if the fear of God does not impact our behavior, that means the Savior is not in your heart. Amen? Yeah. Oh yeah, I fear God, but then I keep doing all these things. And I practice them, and I practice them, and I indulge in them, and I enjoy them. Your heart's not right before God. And you're lying to yourself. You're lying to God. You're lying to your friends, your wife, your husband, if you're saying, oh, I'm a Christian. It's just a lie. So, the Apostle Paul says we have to respect God's laws. We know about the law of gravity, know about the law of electromagnetism. We know there are laws that control our lives and protect us. But there is a deeper spiritual law that is always, I repeat, always, that I say always operating. Galatians chapter 6, verse 7. Do not be deceived. God is not mocked, for whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption, but he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. You keep doing bad, there's going to be a bad result. You keep doing what God has told you to do, and there's going to be a reward. Sometimes you're going to get weary. Sometimes you're going to get discouraged. Sometimes you're going to throw up your hands and say, I don't know why I even bother. So Paul's got an answer for that. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season you shall reap if you do not lose heart, if you don't get discouraged. You've heard the name Henry Blackaby, wrote Experiencing God, How to Know God's Will. If you haven't read that book or gone through that workshop, that would be a good small group study. I've taken several groups through that. So enough people want to do it, we'll do it. So, Henry Blackaby tells about a time that he and his wife went to Russia to visit a family that had left a good home and a good situation to go to northern Russia where it was very, very cold, okay? They got there he said it was obvious that God had led them to be in that place. But right after they got there, they were working with some different churches in the area. Well, these churches got into a conflict. He didn't share in his book what it was about. But there was a sharp dissension, which we've already read. That's not appropriate according to God's word. But they were in a big dissension. And everyone wanted this missionary couple to take their side. And they wanted to minister to all groups, so they didn't take any sides. And because of that, people just left them alone. And they wouldn't be involved in anything that this couple was involved in trying to carry out. They'd made tremendous sacrifices. And so they were planning to return home. They were planning to return home. So the Blackabees, as they talked to them, they empathized. I mean, this was real pain. True discouragement that they were going through in their lives. And they decided that after listening to them and empathizing with them, the Blackabees just started asking some tough questions. What if Jesus had taken the same approach that you took? What if all Jesus was concerned about was whether people liked them or accepted them? What if Jesus had said, I'm not going to die for these people who are rejecting me? Henry says, where would we be if Jesus had taken your attitude? Well, the couple, through tears, humbly accepted this wisdom that Blackaby shared with them. They knew all about sacrifice. But what Blackaby discerned was that even though they made all these sacrifices, they had not adjusted their attitude to follow the Lord's will. And because of that, they were unhappy and discouraged. So they made that deep adjustment. They remained there because that indeed was their calling. Now, my friends, maybe we can go to God and we can say, look at all the sacrifices I've made. Why am I being treated this way? Why am I going through this? Yeah, you can say that. But is that the attitude that God wants us to have? We need to acknowledge Him in all of our ways. That includes
our thoughts.
And as we start the year 2019, I think we need to get real with God. Do we have the right attitude that God wants us to have as we serve Him, as we daily walk with Him? You see, it's easy to read those words in Proverbs. It's a lot harder to apply it. But there's so much joy. There's a harvest to be reaped if we will not grow weary. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for the blessings that you give us, the privilege that you give us, Heavenly Father, to serve you, to be a part of this community of faith here at Liberty Baptist Church. And our prayer this morning is that our hearts can be at peace with your heart. And Heavenly Father, if there's a prayer that needs to be said, surrendering their lives, Heavenly Father, to you, surrendering an attitude that is hindering your work, Heavenly Father, I pray that today that prayer would be made. We pray for every decision that you would have made today, and it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. As we open the doors of our church, we invite you to come as God is leading. If you need to accept Jesus Christ, your personal Lord and Savior, we invite you to come and to know the joy of salvation, to confess your sins, and to know that Christ died for you, to acknowledge that in your life. You may need to join our church because this is where you attend, and your membership needs to be where you attend. You come as God leads. Number 528, I give you my heart. Let's stand as we sing.